to report by uploading first-hand information on the You Report link and be the first to know by simply clicking on any of the links on the sidebar for headlines, domestic and foreign news, economy, security, politics, sports, and more. Stream live on your smartphone and tablets and stay connected. It's pretty easy. Simply download NTN News app from your Google Play Store and you're good to go. NTN News mobile app, your access to real-time information.
Gas pipelines are the arteries for powering electricity. When the artery is burst, then the entire system collapses. Vandalizing gas pipelines is a criminal offense against the Nigerian people. Let us join hands and protect our gas pipelines from the enemies of Nigeria. Report any suspected vandal to the security operatives. Let us stop vandals before they destroy our collective national heritage, so we can have the Nigeria of our dreams, where there will be light at all times. This message is brought to you by the Nigerian Television Authority, NTA.
Our programs are getting better and fresher. And it's because we are thinking about you. NTA, it's all about you.
NTA language.
Jama'a masu kallon labaran NTA.
Hello, and here we are tonight with the top stories of Wednesday. I am Fumi Wakama. Some 335 foreigners are being granted Nigerian citizenship. That's one of the top stories tonight. From the legislature, Senate says to Nigeria Customs Service, stay execution on the ban of importation of vehicles through land borders, while the House on its part is set to investigate the activities of the Financial Reporting Council. Also tonight, trial of the Senate President before the Code of Conduct Tribunal resumes, while the federal government has rearranged Justice Adeniyi Ademola on corruption charges. Stay with us for these and many more tonight. The federal government has granted citizenship to 335 foreigners who met stipulated conditions for such rights as provided for in the Constitution. Minister of Interior Abdurrahman Dembazao announced this while briefing journalists after the meeting of the Federal Executive Council presided over by President Muhammadu Buhari. State House correspondent Adamu Sambo reports that the council also made several other approvals in respect of water and power supply, as well as solid minerals development.
The Federal Executive Council meeting second for the year 2017 deliberated extensively on the recommendations of an interministerial advisory committee as regards the various applications submitted by those interested to becoming Nigerians. Interior Minister Abdurrahman Dembazao, who presented the memo to that effect, said the provisions of the 1999 Constitution as amended were considered in selecting those who met the requirements to be so honored with the citizenship of Nigeria.
The last time this was done was in 2013. So we had some backlog of these applications. We have over 500 applications that we considered. Out of these 500 applications, 335 in total were recommended for citizenship, either by naturalization or by registration. There are 245 that apply for citizenship by naturalization and 90 by registration. And that is what is popularly known as Niger wives. This is for women from foreign countries who are married to Nigerian citizens.
The council, which also decries the high rate of abandoned projects across Nigeria as bane of infrastructure development, approved an outline business case for the concession of the 30 megawatts Gurara hydropower plant to feed the industrial area of Kaduna for enhanced socio-economic activities. Over 1.7 billion naira has also been approved for the completion of Sapke water supply project in Katsina State, designed to provide about 51 million liters of water to 17 communities, as well as 1,200 hectares of irrigable land.
I inherited 117 ongoing and abandoned projects. I inherited a liability of 89 billion naira, that's claims by contractors waiting to be paid, and a total projection of another 250 billion to complete those 117 ongoing projects. So our task has been to concentrate more on completing some of these projects. So we set out to do a technical audit on these projects based on which we prioritize them. This particular project happens to be one of those that it's among the low-hanging fruits and therefore a high priority project, because we spent a little more money in order to get value for the purpose of which the project was intended. And we are going to continue like that. We hope that under the 2017 budget that we'll be able to complete at least 25% of those 170 ongoing projects.
Water Resources Minister Suleiman Adamu also said that as a matter of priority, his ministry will in the next 2 years de-emphasize the execution of new projects so as to complete as many ongoing projects as possible in line with the National Water Resources Master Plan.
That way we'll get value money for money for the country, and we think that because a lot of these projects also have direct impact on the citizenry, there's no reason why they should be abandoned. And this is going to be a policy of this administration to continue to take viable projects and complete them, notwithstanding the fact that they were initiated by different past governments.
He, however, said studies will be embarked upon for additional irrigation and hydro projects in view of their importance to the economic well-being of the country. Also at Wednesday's meeting, the Federal Executive Council has granted approval for the upgrade of softwares for the National Pension Commission, as well as the provision of information system for mining activities as part of the government's economic diversification drive. From the State House, Adamu Sambu, NTA News.
And still at the presidential villa, Nigeria's promise to keep faith with all agreements entered into with the People's Republic of China for enhanced development of infrastructure in the country. President Muhammadu Buhari stated this while granting audience to the Foreign Minister of China, Wang He, at the presidential villa. Again, State House correspondent Adamu Sambo brings us that report.
The federal government, President Muhammadu Buhari, emphasized is very serious about the development of infrastructure in the country and will therefore honor all agreements reached with the Chinese government towards achieving the objective through collaboration and cooperation. In his words, Nigeria ought to have developed beyond this point but neglected infrastructure when it had the resources. Now we want rail, road, power and skills acquisition for the people. The Nigerian leader had visited China in April last year on the invitation of President Xi Jinping, during which Nigeria and the Asian country signed memoranda of understanding on projects valued at billions of dollars. Some of the projects due for immediate implementation include, among others, railways and the Abuja Kefi Expressway, while 100 million yuan will soon be released for agriculture demonstration centers. The Chinese foreign minister described President Buhari's visit to China as very successful, with President Xi Jinping looking forward to greater collaboration between the two countries. Mr. Wang commended efforts being made by the president to diversify the Nigerian economy, stressing that China will be a reliable partner in this regard. As he puts it, "We will collaborate with you to achieve food security and get involved in industrialization, hydropower development, as well as enhancing military and defense sector." The Chinese minister also said his country is well pleased with the successes recorded in the fight against terrorism, as well as the country's recognition of the One China policy. President Muhammadu Buhari also granted audience to Senate President Bukola Saraki behind closed doors.
You see, we are from time to time to always consult on national issues and discuss issues of common interest for the government, getting the government going, getting the National Assembly moving. And as you know, there's nothing as important for us now than the budget process and the work we need to do on those areas.
What will you be telling those who think there's crisis in the National Assembly following the removal of Ndume?
No, there's no crisis in the National Assembly. Things like this do happen, and as you say, the institution is bigger than everybody. And I'm sure he and everybody else will always work for the interests of the institution and therefore the interests of the country.
From the State House, Adamu Sambu, NTA News.
Elsewhere, President Muhammadu Buhari says no Nigerian will be left out in the scheme of things, assuring that better days are here. He said this in a message during the distribution of food items to members of Mpape Artisans Association in Abuja. State House correspondent Gideon Ifade has that report.
On the 22nd of December 2016, Vice President Yemi Osinbajo paid a surprise visit to these artisans at the Papé area of the Federal Capital Territory, where he interacted with them for almost an hour. Vice President Yemi Osinbajo assures them that all shall be well with the country and that their request shall be looked into.
Trying to deal with the Niger Delta, solve that problem, deal with farming, industry and all that, so that the country will make progress. There's no country that can make progress without some pain.
Out of sight is not out of mind, government seems to be saying to them by this visit, and that the promise made to the people of Nigeria will be fulfilled. The delegation led by the chaplain of Aso Villa Chapel, Sheyi Malomo, delivered the president's message to the artisans.
By the president's speech on Christmas Day, when the Abuja community went to visit him, he said Nigeria should exercise patience. Nigeria will be better. We are blessed as a nation. We are blessed as with population. We are blessed with resources. We are now blessed with good leadership. And so it's a matter of time. People will be coming to Nigeria to come and ask, how did we do it? And every one of us will tell them that it is God that has helped us.
Governance, as often said, is making the lives of the people better, and even more, making them patriotic citizens.
In fact, you know, when been told, but you have yet to get to it, it will be as if you are not part of it. But now, today, with what we see, we've experienced it, we've been part of it, we are enjoying it. And we pray for the governance of this moment, that Lord will continue to prolong their days, in Jesus' name. That Lord will give them wisdom to carry Nigeria to the promised land.
Keeping faith with government is the messenger, and the 3,000 artisans here are saying they believe in this government, and they'll be patient to see the fruit of the labor of this government. From Papi Mechanic Village, Jude Onifade, NTA News.
And to the National Assembly, where the Senate has advised the Nigeria Customs Service to suspend further action on the ban of vehicle importation through land borders. National Assembly correspondent Waziri Zoyano reports that senators took this stand while debating a motion at Wednesday's plenary.
Moving the motion, Senator Barrow Jibrin from Kano State suggested that the ban on importation of vehicles through land borders should be allowed through one entry post in each geopolitical zone that has international boundary. This, he argued, will be better than stopping or suspending the importation.
The economy of border villages and towns that depends on the activities of vehicles importation shall be adversely affected to the detriment of all.
Several senators expressed various opinions on the issue.
The Customs Service and its personnel will be overstretched. There will be hostilities from the border communities.
The Senate stands committed with the masses of this country and will always defend the interests of the masses.
The government that is our own, one way or the other, has been misadvised.
The worst part of this policy is that the custom agents have gone back to car dealers in Kaduna, in Kano, in Abuja to seize cars that have already been imported even before the policy.
Wednesday's plenary also considered and approved President Muhammadu Buhari's nomination of Mr. Anthony Mpe Ayine from Cross River State as the Auditor General of the Federation.
He has acquired relevant working experience, professional trainings, and qualifications in accounting and management.
If he was to be converted to the federal service, he would have been on level 14. And the area of contention is that Auditor General Office of the Federation ought to be on level 17.
This position was advertised nationally and internationally, and that there were many people who competed, including serving directors in the ministry, and that the man that is mentioned now came tops.
Those who were in the 7th Senate, 6th Senate, will recall that even at the point of presentation of the report, there was so much protest from some of our colleagues at that time that the man was coming from outside.
Motion on the urgent need to resolve the Ladoke Akintola University strike was also moved, and the Senate advised that all parties should meet to resolve the contending issues.
Implore Oyo and Osun states to expedite action towards resolving the issues and keep the public appraised of steps being taken. Those in support of this prayer say aye. Those against say nay. The ayes have it.
Senators observe a 1 minute silence each for late former governor of Niger State, Abdulkadir Kure, and late Senator Francis Akpozo, who represented Delta South Senatorial District between 1992 and 1993.
Other bills slated for consideration have to be deferred to another legislative days because of a slated public hearing by committees on works and another one by the Joint Committee on Petroleum Upstream and Downstream. From the National Assembly, Waziri Zeyan, NTA News.
And still from the National Assembly, the House of Representatives is to investigate activities of the Financial Reporting Council of Nigeria to ensure compliance with its Establishment Act. The House mandated its Committee on Delegated Legislations and Public Accounts to convene a public hearing and report back within 4 weeks. National Assembly correspondent Ignatius Nkwo reports.
The Financial Reporting Council of Nigeria, established by the National Assembly Act of 2011, is primarily charged with the responsibility of protecting investors and stakeholders in both the public and private sector. Now in 2017, the House of Representatives is worried that the Council appears to be interfering with the functions of the National Assembly. This came in a motion on the matter of urgent public importance moved by the House Minority Leader, Leo Ogo.
That the governance code formulated by the Council as it relates to heads of non-profit making organization is a clear usurpation of the powers of the National Assembly.
Section 72 of the Financial Reporting Council of Nigeria Act gives the Council power, enforcement of compliance with accounting, auditing, corporate governance and reporting standards in Nigeria. That is what it is. No more, no less.
How the body wandered into other issues is still a mystery to me.
I want to say that the FICN has been draconic in our regulations.
It was when we had overzealous chief executives in organizations because they create the kind of confusion that will destroy this country.
The House implored the federal government to establish fire service stations in all the 774 local governments in Nigeria, as moved by Representative Joseph Idowole from Edo State.
But leaving many communities in the local government areas that could be several hours drive from the state capital unprotected. The issue is, can we afford it now? I mean, definitely, the answer is no.
Now, you expect me to bring in investors to invest millions of dollars in the local governments, in the villages, and then there's no fire service. If you go to some of the states and in the local government, most of our markets, they on a daily basis have been destroyed by fire.
Well, the House passed two bills at first reading, and one of them is a bill for an act to amend the Federal Character Commission Act.
Meanwhile, the House has commenced the distribution of the copies of the 2017 budget to members in preparation for the commencement of debates from the National Assembly. Ignatius Nkwo, NTA News.
A functional party system, training and retraining of legislators, autonomy for state houses of assembly, and respect for the principles of checks and balances were identified as some of the factors that will entrench sustainable democracy in Nigeria. This formed part of submissions of a panel of discussants on NTA's current affairs program Tuesday Live, as they examined the role of state legislatures in consolidating democracy.
The legislature at federal and state levels is one of the arms of government that has its role clearly defined in the 1999 constitution as amended. In reality, however, performance of such functions and the extent to which they meet constitutional provisions as well as the expectations of the electorate are quite different.
These differences, panelists say, call for concern, especially with a rising number of constraints bedeviling their efficiencies.
So we really need to do a lot of things to make the legislature, especially at lower level, effective. Because as you go down from the national level to the state and to the local level, governance diminishes and disappears.
Boils down to understanding why they are there. So if you understand this principle, controlling you might, because you know what you're doing.
With all these challenges plaguing state legislatures, what hope is there for the enactment of enlightened laws for the benefit of the populace?
I want to appeal to the chief executives at all levels to respect the power of the legislature, particularly with respect to the appropriation.
If you select or elect legislators who emanate from the constituency, the people, I'm sure when they come to the House, they will know exactly what is their role.
The Constitution has given the legislature the right to be in control of the economy, the social, and the political activities of a state. They should look into that holistically, utilize that.
The House of Representatives at every cycle sets up, they set a legislative agenda, and they are very clear about where they want to be at the end of 4 years. State assemblies should copy from them, partner with civil society, and be able, you know, to collaborate with those that can enrich the policy process.
They agreed that the legislature is the carrier and navigator of democracy, and with the growing yearnings for a better Nigeria to be achieved through it, efforts to strengthen the legislative institutions would inevitably be at the front burner. Joseph Johnson, NTA News.
And to the judiciary, the trial of Senate President Dr. Bukola Saraki before the Code of Conduct Tribunal on charges of false declaration of assets has resumed after about 2 months' break. At Wednesday's sitting, a witness cleared the position on some of the properties said to have been falsely declared. Judiciary correspondent Femi Okewo has details.
With the close to 2 months' break in this matter, one can evidently see that fatigue is setting in, both for the prosecution and the defense, and of course the witnesses that have to travel from far and near to testify in this matter. That is why in most advanced legal climes, high-profile matters like these are expeditiously determined. With the onset of 2017, let's see what pace this case will now take. For instance, at the resumption of trial this Wednesday, a prosecution witness, Michael Wetgas, who had earlier testified on some of the properties the Senate president was allegedly said to have wrongly declared, went through cross-examination, and all he had to do was to reassert his earlier positions.
Our first witness, who was cross-examined for over 6 months, was discharged today, and we can now call the next witness.
It did not change the narrative as far as the cross-examination is concerned. It did not change anything at all as far as we are concerned. The cross-examination had shown the major loopholes, the defects as far as their case is concerned.
Now, trial is expected to continue on the 17th of January, hopefully with more prosecution witnesses testifying. In Abuja, Femi Okewu, NTA News.
And still staying with the judiciary, following the amendment of its charges, the federal government has rearranged Justice Adeniyi Ademola of the Federal High Court Abuja on a 16-count charge of corruption. At the rearrangement, another defendant was charged along with Justice Ademola. Here again is Femi Okewu with details.
Justice Judo Keke of the FCT High Court, Justice Adeniyi Ademola, a judge of the Federal High Court, is being tried on a 16-count charge of, among others, receiving three installments of 10 million naira each between March 11th and 16th, 2016, dealing in illegal property to the tune of about 175 million naira with a private company, and receiving an unlawful BMW car gift through his son on the 5th of January 2015. The car gift was said to have come through a senior advocate of Nigeria, Joe Agui, who this time was charged along with Justice Adeniyi Ademola. They all pleaded not guilty to the charges.
There was an amended charge brought today against the accused person, which brought in a new defendant into the case. And based on that, fresh plea was taken.
We didn't want it to stall the arraignment of the two defendants. That was why we took his name out of the original charge. But now that he's in the country, we brought him in so that we can commence trial.
The bail conditions that had prevailed before Wednesday's rearrangement was extended to the defendants. Now, with the amendment of charges and the arraignment completed, the trial has been slated to commence on the 16th of January, and it will run through the 6th, 17th and 18th of the month. From the FCT High Court, Femi Okewu, NTA News.
And still from the courts, 3 years after she was granted bail, the former managing director of First City Monument Bank, Rosemary Osifo, is yet to fulfill her bail conditions. The Federal High Court sitting in Lagos has, however, varied the terms of bail following application by her counsel. Vera Chiwuba also reports that the trial of former managing director of NEMASA, Patrick Apobolokeme, was also stalled.
CMB manager Rosemary Osifo was charged with 30 million naira fraud by the EFCC. She was arraigned on the 5th of December 2013 on a one-count charge bordering on the offense. She was charged alongside her bank. The prosecution counsel, Susan, had alleged that the accused defrauded a bank customer, one retired Deputy Inspector General of Police, Achebong Nkanga, of the sum of 30 million naira. The money was alleged to have been obtained from the fixed deposit of the customer. The accused had been at the Creek Reprising, following her inability to meet the terms of bail. The defense counsel, Akombi, brought an application asking the court to vary the terms by dispensing with the condition of providing a property owner in the bail terms. The application was not opposed by the prosecution. Justice Seidu granted the accused bail in the sum of 10 million naira with two sureties in like sum. He, however, ordered that she be remanded in Kirikiri Prison pending perfection of bail terms. The ongoing trial of former Director General of NEMASA, Patrick Apobolokeme, and five others was adjourned till the 28th of February due to absence of the 11th and last witness. Also, the case of 3.1 billion naira Zamfara state debt before the Federal High Court could not be heard. Ecobank had commenced garnishee proceeding against the state seeking to recover the debt. 17th of January has been fixed for hearing. In Lagos, Vera Chimuba, NTA News.
President Muhammadu Buhari has congratulated Chief John Umodo on his election as the President General of Ohanaeze Ndigbo, the Pan-Igbo Social Cultural Organization. President Buhari believes that Chief Umodo is eminently qualified for the job, given his long years of distinguished service to the nation, which includes Minister of Civil Aviation in the Second Republic under President Shehu Shagari and Minister of Information and Culture during the administration of General Abdusalami Abubakar. The president appeals to Ndigbo as well as wider community of Nigerians to support the new leadership to fulfill their mandate and implement the vision for Ohanaeze Ndigbo. President Buhari looks forward to working with the new leadership and assures Ohanaeze Ndigbo that his administration will continue to be a partner in progress in implementing suggestions, measures and programs to advance the unity, development and prosperity of the country. And this is just coming in now that the Nigeria Union of Petroleum and Natural Gas Workers, NUPENG, has suspended its three-day warning strike. This followed a meeting with Labour Minister Chris Ngige. We'll bring you more on this much later. You're still watching NTA News Extra, and you can watch this news live online via the NTA mobile app, which you can download on your Android device at the Google Play Store or at the Apple Store if you use devices with iOS. And still to come on NTA News Extra, the state of primary health care and how women are boosting food production. We will be back shortly.
From what we have seen, we have the capacity which we can rapidly develop or feed in ourselves. If we don't import rice, we stop importing corn and other grains, Nigeria will have plenty of money to invest into developing industries, especially manufacturing, textiles and so on, and develop iron and steel, and complement the infrastructure development. So really, the opportunities are virtually limitless, and we are very, very aware of this, and we are prepared to exploit it to the fullest.
Today, what do you see? The obvious, or much more? Do you hear a color tune, or the talents of thousands paying off? Do you see an instant message, or millions of strengthened relationships? Do you see an app, or creative entrepreneurs? An email or multiples of successful business transactions? Do you see charity or renewed faith in our shared humanity? Do you hear the laughter of millions of people in Africa's largest family? It's never enough to see only what's before us. That's why MTN is empowering a tomorrow that's driven by digital technology and made for Africa by Africans.
For quick and easy banking on your mobile, like checking your balance or transferring money, use our mobile banking services today. To find out more, visit us online at ecobank.com. Move on up with EcoBank, the Pan-African bank.
If there's any university that can be called federal, ours is the Federal University.
Afe Babalola University, the fastest growing educational institution in Africa.
Hello?
Welcome to the M6 Challenge. Using your new Geone M6, carry out everything on that list, starting now. Congratulations, you have passed the test.
Gioni M6 with a 5,000 milliampere battery that lets you go on for 2 days on a single charge. Gioni M6, always in power.
The Tony Elumelu Foundation's $100 million entrepreneurship program is empowering Africa's next business leaders. 54 countries, 10,000 entrepreneurs. Become a Tony Elumelu entrepreneur. Apply now.
The Future Assured Project and its components, Get Involved, initiated by the wife of the President, Her Excellency Aisha Muhammadu Buhari, is not relenting in championing the cause of Nigerian women and children. Its provision of free medical screening, educational support, and the fight against malnutrition, especially in the Northeast, has indeed informed international recognition, partnerships, and awards.
We are very grateful and appreciative for your wonderful gesture you have afforded to us.
With Future Assured, Nigerian women and children are assured of a bright future.
Future is assured when we join hands to promote the health of our women and children. Get involved.
Get involved and support the Future Assured initiative. Future Assured, promoting and protecting the lives of Nigerian women and children.
You're still watching NTA News Extra, and we'll begin the segment with the health sector. President Muhammadu Buhari has approved the appointment of Dr. Faisal Shuaib as the Executive Secretary of the National Primary Healthcare Development Agency. Dr. Shuaib, a public health specialist, is currently a Senior Program Officer Africa for the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in Seattle, USA, where he is responsible for developing and implementing strategies on polio outbreak response activities in Africa. Dr. Shuaib coordinated Nigeria's successful response to the outbreak of Ebola virus disease as the incident manager of the Ebola Emergency Operations Center in 2014. He was also a member of the six-man panel established to assess the response of the World Health Organization to the global Ebola outbreak in 2014. He also provided technical advice to the Federal Ministry of Health and the NPHCDA in areas of immunization and polio eradication between 2012 and 2015. Still on health, apart from its considerations as the cornerstone for healthcare delivery, medical practitioners and public health experts globally are unanimous in their resolution that effective implementation of primary health care has the greatest disease burden of over 80%. How much priority is accorded this very important level of health care in Nigeria? In this report, health correspondent Rabi Abdallah takes a look at the state of primary health care in the country against the background of the present administration's efforts to reposition it with 10,000 centers.
It is the first contact of the common man in the healthcare system with the potential to offer basic qualitative healthcare that revolves around prevention and treatment of diseases. Primary healthcare. Findings show that 70% of Nigerians can and should ideally receive care at primary care level. 20% are meant to go to secondary, that is, the general hospitals, while 10% are supposed to go to tertiary health facilities, such as the National Hospital and others, for cases that cannot be handled at the lower levels of care. The situation in Nigeria, however, is such that out of the 30,000 primary health centers in the country, only 20% of them are working. The resultant effect is the overdependence on both secondary and tertiary health facilities, which in turn get overstretched. The Muhammadu Buhari-led administration decided to take the bull by the horn with a major initiative of revitalizing 10,000 primary health care centers in the country.
We've started the race towards the attainment of universal coverage.
It starts the process of getting primary care services available to all Nigerians everywhere, especially in the rural areas, and it is a great development.
The flag off of the revitalized Kuchigoro Primary Healthcare Model Health Center in the FCT, one of the 110 picked from each senatorial district in the first batch, gives us an insight into what the facelift translates to.
They constructed a new tuberculosis and leprosy center. They have 19 medical personnel here with about 3 doctors. So you can see that if there are personnel...
How many were there before the revitalization?
Only 9. And now we added 10. I brought the only one doctor there. Now added 2 more doctors.
This 3-week-old baby, named after President Muhammadu Buhari, is the first to be delivered at the revitalized primary health center.
The practical demonstration of political will and commitment at Asin to the revitalization of this primary health center will no doubt create demand for services among the people, which underscores the need for sustainability.
I'm even praying my next pregnancy, I did my antenatal here, everything, immunization, any of my child that has any fever or a headache, anything at all, I will be here in this primary health center in Kuchingoro. And I must appreciate what the government did.
I've seen the change, and I thank Baba Buhari, because before we are thinking the change is not possible, but now change are starting with Kuchingoro community. And then my prayer for Baba Buhari, anywhere he enter, my God continue to leave him successfully.
Amen.
So we're going to bring in the private sector determination, innovation, ideas, logistics, to make sure that it's hitch-free as we move from state to state. We are partnering with the Ministry of Health on this.
The issue of sustainability. We plan to build a row of shops behind to also generate some resources into the facility. These are things that we're putting in place to make sure that this revitalized entity survives.
As the nation witnesses a new golden opportunity for efficient and effective implementation of primary health care under President Muhammadu Buhari, states, local governments, and other key players are expected to give the needed support for optimal success. In Abuja, Rabi Abdallah, NTA News.
And elsewhere, the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology has achieved a feat in the research and development of some nutraceutical and therapeutic food products with a move to commercialize the two products. The products are targeted at alleviating the pains of over 40 million Africans suffering from sickle cell disease and treating severe malnutrition, estimated to be over 106.5 billion naira from an annual demand in excess of 90,000 metric tons. Justin Bentwe reports.
This is coming as the ministry signs an MOU with a private pharmaceutical company for the development and commercialization of the food supplements, which are breakthroughs of the Federal Institute of Industrial Research, OSHODI, FIRO, in the spirit of the private partnership initiative of the federal government. This is in furtherance of the unrelenting effort of the government at ensuring that indigenous research findings and innovations do not remain on the shelves, but are taken to the markets for economic growth.
These products that you will assist the nation and the world to commercialize will help us now to stop importing these items. And then we will not only meet our needs in the country, we are going to now export these products to other parts of the world.
FIRO affirms the products submitted have been fully analyzed and clinically tested and found to be potent in eliminating and reducing the effect of health and nutrition challenges confronting the black race.
It is important to know that in the process of commercialization of indigenous technologies, jobs will be created, wealth will be generated, foreign exchange will be conserved, national GDP will be enhanced through the productive sector of the economy.
As a company, we are accepting to work with FIRO to finalize the development and commercialization of these products.
The MOU signed has a broad objective of enhancing the growth of manufacturing concern of indigenous technologies through effective local technology transfer program to promote rapid industrialization, wealth, and job creation. In Abuja, Justin Bemunyi, NTA News.
And to agriculture, where investigation reveals that women in Nigeria remain the backbone of agriculture and rural development. Agriculture correspondent Musa Baba Aliu reports that women in northern part of Nigeria are not left behind as they participate actively in the production, processing and marketing of agricultural produce.
The Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations recognizes women as the backbone of agricultural and rural development, as they contribute largely to the national food and livestock production. In Nigeria, especially in northern part of the country, records have shown that almost 70% of agricultural activities are done by women. In Kano State, for instance, the women are participating in all agricultural activities, including dry season farming. Malama Hindatu Muhammad is a major rice producer in Bunkure local government area of Kano State. Despite the fact that she's physically challenged, she produces over 400 bags of assorted grains annually.
I use the profit of my produce to buy land, and so far I have close to 10 plots of land.
There are many like Hindatu across the northern state, but one thing they have in common is the difficulties in accessing input and processing machines.
Rice milling machine is what we need most at the moment.
The one is really fitting there is only this fertilizer. But thank God, when Fadama come in, Fadama 3AF, they are supported with this. There is no problem of fertilizer, no problem of inputs, no problem of insecticides.
We have encouraged them, and with the women that I came in to participate in the rice farming, I'm sure that more are coming this year. And we are really, really working very hard, and the women are really responding.
Chemicals and pumps. We are expecting a large number of pumps in the next 2 weeks because they need pumps for irrigation.
Work with the other stakeholders, work with the Minister of Women Affairs, work with labor and productivity to ensure that women are given enough empowerment, economic empowerment through skill development and microfinance.
The women are also participating in the 2016-2017 dry season farming. In Abuja, Musa Baba Aliyu, NTA News.
And still on agriculture, for close to a century since Irish potato production began on the Jos Plateau as an immigrant crop, its popularity has continued to gain momentum with corresponding yield in parts of Nigeria's farming communities. Hamza Musa Makarfi, who visited the Hunkuyi Irrigation Hub of Kaduna State, reports that like on the plateau, potato production promotes employment and income for the farmers.
The farmers in this area begin the season on a positive note. Their comparative advantage is water availability from a dam constructed by the government of Kaduna State, large expanse of land and good weather condition. Conspicuous among vegetables and tuberous crops are these unique unequal leaflets of sizes and shapes of Irish potatoes. The farmers rely on the old tradition of tilling the soil and watering the fields to grow the crop. Seedlings are sourced from the hub of potato production on the Jos Plateau. The farmers have peculiar expressions on their specific names. There is SP, Alice, Diamond, Nicola, and Pakistan varieties. The Diamond variety is the most successful. On a scale, the Hunkuyi producers insist the potato is more lucrative as much as the crop can be stored and preserved within a limited period of time, unlike other vegetables. At the start of this week, a bag of potatoes sold for 10,000 naira, and a basket between 1 and 3,000, depending on the quantity.
In the next couple of months, the price of potatoes may actually go beyond the reach.
However, the farmers have expectations to increase yield and better pricing by getting government to address key concerns of input supply, improved seedlings, pests and disease control, and related challenges in the value chain. On a larger dimension, data collated by different sources over time reveals Nigeria's potato production increased exponentially from 18,000 tons in 1961 to more than 1 million tons since 2008, with Plateau State producing the bulk of the commodity. The Raw Materials Research and Development Council, while presenting its findings in 2013 on potato as industrial raw material, identifies Nigeria as the fourth biggest producer in sub-Saharan Africa. Findings also show states with comparative advantage are into making potato production an influential crop in Nigeria, as Kaduna State committed to its commercial production and processing through partnership with the private sector. But what even makes potato tick, as many perceive it, as comfort food and highly urbanized?
So they are a good source of carbohydrate, which provides a good source of energy. In addition to that, they are equally rich in micronutrients, the vitamins, the minerals like magnesium, iron, some iron. They are rich in vitamin C, the B complex, the B vitamins. And to that extent, they have good nutritional value.
Participants say government's realistic vision of improving agricultural portions in Nigeria should also focus on the development of potatoes production to satisfy the needs of consumers and commodity export. Hamza Musa Makalipi, NTA News.
And potatoes happen to be one of my favorites. Turning to security matters now, the theater commander of Operation Lafia Dole, Major General Lucky Irabo, has displayed recovered materials from Boko Haram members at Camp Zero in Sambisa Forest. While expressing determination to entrench peace in the northeast, he attributed the successes recorded to the intelligence network.
"Terrorists never find a foothold," General Irabo said. "Over 60 Boko Haram terrorists have been killed at various clearance operations, recovered several weapons and arrested over 900 terrorists, while two have surrendered to the military."
"A set of questions that tells you how to use various armaments. So giving you lesson by lesson. So that tells you that perhaps we are establishing something close to his crew. So that's what we find in this."
We seem to have a little mix-up there. We'll get back to that later. Still on security matters, the Chief of Army Staff, Lieutenant General Tukur Buratai, has reaffirmed the Nigerian Army's commitment to partner with the Nigerian Immigration Service to further strengthen the country's internal security. This was when he received the Controller General, Nigeria Immigration Service, Mohammed Babandede, at the Army headquarters here in Abuja.
Visit of the Comptroller General Nigerian Immigration Service, Mohammed Babandede, on the Chief of Army Staff, Lieutenant General Tukur Buratai, was a platform to brainstorm on issues and fortify Nigeria's land borders through synergy, intelligence sharing, and capacity building.
"I would like to see if the military can assist us in training our border patrol wing. Government has committed resources this year by allowing us to purchase patrol vehicles, surveillance equipment. Also, they have committed in terms of communication equipment, but I need to build the men to do the job."
The Comptroller General says the Nigerian Immigration Service will soon embark on registration of non-Nigerians at local government levels at their place of residence for effective database management. Chief of Army Staff Lieutenant General Tukur Buratai reiterated Nigerian Army's readiness to support the Nigerian Immigration Service at Border Patrol through the establishment of forward operation bases, which will equally provide adequate security for personnel of the Immigration Service.
"Intelligence sharing, it will help us, you know, in getting intelligence, you know, for us to tackle this issue of the cross-border banditry."
The Chief of Army Staff called on the Nigerian Immigration Service to ensure to register all Nigerians who were not yet captured for effective database management in the country. In Abuja, Olajide Bello,
NTA News.
A non-governmental organization known as With Buhari We Stand has commended the Buhari administration for its continued effort at restoring peace in the Northeast. Patience Christopher reports that the group led a peaceful rally to the army headquarters in Abuja.
Following the successes recorded in the fights against Boko Haram terrorist group in the Northeast and the military takeover of Sambisa Forest, the group With Buhari We Stand led a peaceful rally which took off from Old Parade Ground down to Army Headquarters in Abuja to appreciate the present administration for a job well done. Members of the group say the efforts of Buhari's administration in restoring peace in the troubled areas will fast-track the return of the internally displaced persons back to their homes.
We stand for objectivity. We stand for honesty. We stand for support to the present government. We make bold to do that because in the area to which we've always come out to support the government, which concerns the security specifically, we've seen a government that has been very committed, dedicated, and given all it can to ensure that security is something that Nigeria can be proud of.
We stand with Buhari. We stand with Nigerian Army for rescuing Sambisa Forest, for delivering some of the Chibok girls back to us, and we're hoping that the remaining Chibok girls will still be, they will still come back to their parents and come back to us in Nigeria.
It is not just all about Buhari alone. We feel at present the government is in place, and who is piloting that affair is Buhari. That is why for now we said with Buhari we stand and want to operate under this umbrella.
Spokesperson of the group, Jonathan Ade Kogi, called on Nigerians to always encourage and support the president for a better Nigeria. In Abuja, Patience Gail Christopher, NTA News.
The Defense Headquarters says in preparation for the 2017 Armed Forces Remembrance Day, the Federal Secretariat Road through Eagle Square will be temporarily closed till the 15th of January. A statement by the Acting Director Defense Information, Brigadier General Rabi Abubakar, says this is to ensure hitch-free rehearsals by the military. The statement further adds that during the period, alternate routes will be made available for motorists plying that axis, with security personnel supervising the diversions to avoid lock jams. Members of the public are therefore advised not to panic at the sight of the troops, as the rehearsals will only take place in the morning hours. You're still watching NTA News Extra. Up ahead, wrangling over arbitrary charges on transactions. We'll bring you details in just a moment.
Appreciating the resilience of the Nigerian Armed Forces, join the Minister of Defense, Service Chiefs and other stakeholders in the defense sector as we pray for the Nigerian Armed Force veterans of various world and internal conflicts. Venue, National Mosque, Friday 13 January 2017. Time, 1 p.m. The welfare of the troops, the veterans and the families of our fallen heroes is the responsibility of all. Be a part of the national appreciation of the resilience of the Armed Forces, our veterans and the families of the fallen heroes. The efficacy of prayer is not to be underestimated. Join other Nigerians as we pray for Nigeria, our troops, our veterans, our fallen heroes, and those they left behind. Join us. Announcer, Brigadier General Rabi Abubakar for National Planning Committee.
Hello?
Welcome to the M6 Challenge. Using your new Geely M6, carry out everything on that list, starting now.
Geony M6 with a 5,000 milliampere battery that lets you go on for 2 days on a single charge.
Geony M6, always in power.
Do you crave class? Do you have taste? And do you care about comfort? If you do, then for your next event, a stay away from home, a a business trip, or a holiday, visit Jade's Hotel at 24 Undola Crescent, Wuse Zone 5, Abuja. Check out our world-class services, exquisite suites, restaurant and bar, gymnasium, spa and grills, and our outdoor catering services and cuisines. At Jade's, it can only be better. For bookings and reservations, visit us today at 24 Undola Crescent, Wuse Zone 5, Abuja, or visit www.jadeshotels.com. Our email address is info@jadeshotels.com. You can also call us on 09291-9321 or 0810-909-7956. Jade's Hotels, welcome to life. Nigerians. Suicide bombers are not spirits. They are not ghosts. They are human beings like you and me. They live amongst us. They are your neighbors. They are your friends today, but terrorists tomorrow. So you must know your neighbor now. Security begins with you and me. Know your neighbor. Be vigilant. Be security conscious. Report suspicious persons, objects, and movements to the police and other security agencies. The security of our nation is a duty for you and me.
If you see something, say something. Nigeria, unite against terrorism.
This message is brought to you by the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
Thanks for being there. You're still watching NTA News Extra. Business customer laments arbitrary charges on transactions as operators advise the Central Bank of Nigeria to come up with lasting solution to tackle the challenges in the foreign exchange market. Abdullahi Mohammed has details on Business News.
A warm welcome to Business News. The Central Bank of Nigeria has been urged to come up with practicable solutions to the prevailing challenges in the foreign exchange market. This has become necessary to check the increasing exchange rate of the naira to the dollar. The president of the Association of Bureau of Exchange of Nigeria, Aminu Godabe, says the association is committed to supporting the Apex Bank in checking illegal activities at the power market.
See, once we can come up with a mechanism that will defeat their operation, I'm telling you honestly, the activities will be completely eliminated. It depends on we, the operators in that market.
There's been growing concern by bank customers over what they described as excessive charges on almost every transaction in recent times. Amechi Pius during the week monitored the development and a report.
These charges include charges on every withdrawal from an ATM when a customer is making withdrawal from another bank's ATM.
Several times I've been seeing a lot that they're deducting my money.
Sometimes people don't know that they deduct money for all these charges or whatsoever.
There's also a monthly maintenance charge on ATM, short message service, otherwise known as SMS alert, charged by banks on a monthly basis depending on the customer's volume of transaction. Of great concern to this financial expert, Dr. Oladimeji Alo, is the replacement of COT with maintenance charge, which all the banks charge on every current account.
Don't tell me I'm stopping A, and then you come back and introduce B, which is almost the same thing as the A you removed. That's what I'm making. And not only that, nobody had explained to the public what had happened.
That's Business News. Thanks for being part of it. News Extra continues shortly.
And the Minister of Communications, Mr. Adebayo Shitu, says the telecommunications revolution in Nigeria has been quite rewarding, but pointed out that a lot still needs to be done in the march towards digital and knowledge-based economy. The minister stated this while inaugurating the board of the Nigerian Communications Commission, NCC, where Ruben Okala reports.
Despite the challenges of poor quality of service, dropped calls, unsolicited text messages, and other hiccups in the telecommunication industry, Nigeria remains one of the fastest growing in the world, with almost 160 million GSM subscribers, contributing about 10% to the gross domestic product and a tele density of 109.65%. communication minister believes that the NCC board members will bring their experiences to bear in sustaining the growth of the industry, with the understanding that last year investment in the industry was put at $68 billion. Of this figure, $35 billion is from foreign direct investment.
A national ICT roadmap in Nigeria has been drawn by this ministry with intent and commitment to refocus the telecoms and ICT sector as an enabler for sustainable development for our nation. Without doubt, this would help us to optimize opportunities for wealth and job creation, as well as increase revenue generation for government.
Olabiyi Durojaye is the chairman of the board.
And we want to assure the nation by the special grace of God Almighty that we will not disappoint the president, we will, and the nation. We'll try our best to ensure level playing grounds for the operators of the industry and ensure that they play the game according to the rules.
Nigeria's communication environment opened up in 2003 with the Nigeria Communication Act that paved way for the global system for mobile communication, GSM. The board is made up of 9 members, 6 non-executive and 3 executives. Number one on their charge is to address the problem of quality of service in the networks. Ruben Okala, NTA News.
A bit of tongue twister there for me, Nigerian Communications Commission. Moving on now. Good conditions of roads enhances socio-economic activities and adds beauty to the immediate environment. After many years of neglect, many federal roads in the southeast have received some sort of attention, ranging from rehabilitation to total reconstruction. Chinyere Okoye now reports.
These roads have been in deplorable states, causing untold hardship to road users without any hope of possible palliatives. Even commercial motorcyclists, which became better alternatives for some road users, so far the same fate. Heavy-duty vehicles were equally affected, and by extension, the goods and services they render. However, when the situation became so unbearable, appeals to the federal government to remedy the situation became imperative, prompting the immediate action by the government. As a result, some of the roads have been attended to, while some are still on the drawing board. The prompt action by the federal government has brought relief to road users.
A lot of things have improved. He has been able to touch some roads. He has been able to make sure that at least people have access to their various homes and communities.
If they were performing like this, we would have long realized this road.
Today, all the people living this area, from here to Amufu, everybody enjoying it.
Officials of the Federal Ministry of Works and some of the contractors said, though they are challenged by inadequate funding, give an assurance of timely completion of their roads.
Most of the federal roads here in the states are in good condition, apart from the few ones in which they have not awarded contract.
The roads that are ongoing, reasonable percentage of them are almost completed. They would have been completed if there was appropriation.
If there is enough funds for the project as scheduled, maximum in 2 dry seasons we finish.
Some of the road users have appealed to the government to ensure that contractors adhere strictly to the terms and conditions of agreement. As federal government continues to receive kudos for this effort so far, many are of the view that regular maintenance of these roads should be encouraged to ensure that socio-economic activities in this part of the country do not suffer setback. From the Enugu Port Harcourt Expressway, Chinyere Okoye reporting for NTA News Extra.
Meanwhile, the federal government has once again demonstrated its resolve to complete the second Niger Bridge. This follows the announcement of release of over 14 billion naira to the contractor handling the project. As Nigerians continue to hail this laudable step, Austin Edomodo made efforts to ascertain the situation and brought back this report.
The operative of the construction company Jilos Beja Consortium Limited could not allow NTA News crew and other media reporters access to the project site Phone calls to the public relations officer of the company were not answered.
But what I'm trying to tell you, you cannot, as a journalist, you cannot just leave
the news is
house.
Is on air everywhere that work is going on here. But yes. We cannot, and we it's kept everywhere. The Wi-Fi.
See, if work is going on. That is not my concern. My concern is this. I secure this environment. Before you come to this environment, you have to take permission before you come inside.
Let me ask again. Otherwise, is work going on here?
Don't ask me any question.
Meanwhile, the Minister of Labour and Employment, Dr. Chris Ngige, while speaking on NTNisha Current Affairs program, said the federal government has released 14 billion naira for the recommencement of work on the second Niger Bridge.
14 billion naira was approved for Mrs. Edwin-Beda at the Rami Meter. Those who are doing the construction, they are the contractors. Last December, they were approved the money. By this January, Edwin-Beda will assess the fund.
The Senate Committee on Works, during their visit to Anambra State last year, promised to ensure that the Onitsha Amansi axis of the Onitsha Enugu Expressway is captured in the 2017 budget. Other federal roads begging for attention in Anambra State include Obanewi Okigwe Road, Umeza Nam Kogi Road, as well as Onitsha Adane Nsoka Road. In the meantime, traders and other stakeholders in Onitsha have appealed to the federal government to expedite action in the construction of the second Niger Bridge to boost the economy of the Southeast region.
The completion of the project, it will even affect our business in a sense that container can be able to be coming in and going out.
The Southeast cannot move without that bridge. We can't. So our stand is government should do something as a matter of urgency.
They believe that with the second Niger Bridge, the lifespan of the existing one will be elongated. In Onitsha, Uchenna Nwekoyo, NTN News.
Oh, wow. Uchenna reporting there. You're watching NTN News Extra. And a break beckons now. We will be back shortly.
The attention of the management of the NTA Television College JOS has been drawn to some illegal websites currently operated in the name of the college by some unscrupulous individuals to defraud applicants. In view of this, the college authority wishes to inform the public that any person or group asking applicants to make financial transactions should be considered as online scammers and fraudsters. All admission forms can only be purchased at the college or any NTA station across the nation. Also, members of the public are to kindly contact the college before making any payments on 0803-721-6725 or 0803-314-6151. NTA Television College JOS does not operate any online or individual accounts. Be warned that the college will not be held accountable for any online payments. Announcer, Management.
The production, distribution, and sale of counterfeit and fake drugs is a corrupt practice and a crime against humanity. This has informed several measures and strategies to combat fake drugs, including introduction of anti-counterfeiting cutting-edge technologies to detect fake drugs on the spot. These technologies are being deployed to all the states across the Federation, as well as the internally displaced people's camps. The President, Muhammadu Buhari, and his team are committed to this fight.
The federal government of Nigeria, in line with its anti-corruption agenda and posture, will fight a total war against fake drugs and other unwholesome regulated products in order to ensure that Nigerians remain healthy and well.
Lend your support and join NAFDAC to rid the country of fake drugs and unwholesome regulated products. NAFDAC, safeguarding the health of the nation.
What's up, sweetheart? You really look like you're up to something.
I have a secret.
Okay.
I'll be going to Europe next week.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Like you have your visa, your passport, your plane ticket.
No, not that way. Some men are helping us. We pay them, they take us through the desert, and then we cross the sea.
Into Europe. The desert, the sea. Yeah. Isn't that the route where many have died?
Yes, it is indeed a very dangerous journey. In 2016 alone, 4,900 people died while crossing the Mediterranean Sea to enter Europe. Many were Nigerians. For the very few who survived the journey, they are forced into prostitution or other crimes just to survive. Eventually, they will be arrested and deported to Nigeria. Don't be a victim. Don't go this way.
This is a public service announcement brought to you by NTA.
A king, his throne, his subjects. A chronicle of centuries of conquest, strength, struggle, and victory. A thriving culture. The Nigerian Television Authority presents Benin, Might, Mystery, and Myth. Benin Kingdom, showing on the network service of the NTA.
Still watching NTA News Extra, and we begin with the energy sector now. The Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation's three refineries in Kaduna, Port Harcourt, and Warri have resumed production of diesel and kerosene. The resumption of refining the two products is expected to balance the disequilibrium in demand and supply of the products being experienced in recent times in some parts of the country. Speaking on the production level of the Warri Refinery, the Managing Director of the Warri Refining and Petrochemical Company, Solomon Ladenego, said the plant has been doing well since the crude distillation unit became active again last Saturday, which the refinery now refines 2 million litres of kerosene and 3 million litres of diesel daily.
Good ones. So people should not panic. They are just to be loaded. We have the plant is still running and we continue to run. So let's not put any fear. We should move here and loading will continue.
The managing director of the Port Harcourt Refining Company, Dr. Bafred Enujo, said Port Harcourt Refinery is producing 3 million litres of diesel daily, in addition to millions of litres of kerosene being churned out by the refinery on a daily basis. Meanwhile, the Kaduna Refinery is also swung into action, producing millions of litres of products to ease out the situation in supply and distribution of petroleum products nationwide. While efforts are intensified to diversify the Nigerian economy, the country continues to explore the prospects of increasing her reserves of hydrocarbons. Seun Ogunloye has been touring Niger State along with a team from the IBB University Lapai, which has been searching the Bida Basin for oil and gas. This report is the first of a two-part package on the findings of the team.
Atishabakolo in Niger State, a rather remote community with little claim to fame. It is kilometers away from any highway. The only road leading there can be treacherous and the terrain is rocky. Coming here must be motivated by something beyond the ordinary, and that is what this report is about. The fortunes of Atishabakolo could change very fast, thanks to this man, Professor Nuhu Obache of the Department of Geology and Geography
at the Ibrahim Badamasi Babenda University, Lapai, in Niger State.
This is Patricia Bakulu, and here is a very big accumulation of sediments, and the highest prospect is here.
5 years of extensive research by his team has revealed that there is reason to suspect that the ground in Patricia Bakulu could hold substantial reserves of hydrocarbons. There had always been suspicion that the Bida Basin, which stretches from Lokoja in Kogi State to Kontogora in Niger State, has hydrocarbons in its bowel. With other basins in Niger Republic, Chad Republic, and Sudan, where oil has been discovered in commercial quantity. The Niger State government some years ago set up a committee to look into every claim, but this effort fizzled out. The academic research team from the IBB University, led by Professor Obaje, took up the challenge. It carried out preliminary geological mapping and completed a prospectivity map of the Bida Basin.
The oil will be there for millions of years, nobody knows that. But you must do geological mapping, you must do magnetic geophysical, you must do gravity, all kind of geophysical, and then do seismic, and then eventually be able to select the drilling place.
The team also conducted geochemical analysis of samples from drilled shallow wells in Age and Kudu, both in Niger State. It came to the conclusion that there are prospective hydrocarbon reserves which deserve a second look, especially in Kudu and Patricia Bakulu, which they described as geological bright spots.
And at the moment, we have even submitted a technical report to the current administration with the intention of upscaling the research, you know, to national level.
In the second part of this report, we will focus on another twist in this story and the reaction of the NNPC.
You can watch out for the second part of that report by Sheun Ogunluyi. And sports is just ahead on NTN News Extra. To stay with us.
Okay, sir. You may now go in for your interview.
Thank you.
My shoe. And to think I just bought this very expensive foreign shoe 2 months ago.
So sorry about your shoes. This is why I advise my friends to always patronize made in Nigeria product. See this shoe? It's made in Nigeria and I've had it for 2 years and it's still as good as the day I bought it.
Made in Nigeria products are good quality. And stringent government regulations and certification now mean the goods made in Nigeria meet international standards. Make the patriotic choice today. Buy right. Buy made in Nigeria.
This is a public service announcement brought to you by NTA.
With heavy hearts, the Idiomu family announced the passing away of their son, brother, husband and father, Mr. Valentine Idiomu, Deputy Controller of Customs, aged 56 years old. Burial arrangements Friday 13th of January, service of songs and Mass at Church of the Transfiguration, VGC, Lagos, time 11 a.m. Same day, Christian Wake at Gbekebo Quarters, Odoni, Bayelsa State from 7 p.m. Signed, Major General B.T. Idiomu for the family.
And we begin this segment with global tidbits. President Barack Obama makes final request